from sin that long had enslaved me, his precious blood he gave to redeem. Now I belong to
starting note?
No.
Okay. Praise the Lord.
If I start on one note, I think that would be consistent throughout it. I think. No. Hey. It's always a pleasure to be here.
Amen.
With you folks. We pray for you folks all the time. Amen. Pray for God's mercy and God's grace. God will bless you. And Father will give us a wonderful new building to be able to meet in. Because our Father has it all.
Amen.
He owns it all. And the Son came down here to earth to die on Calvary's cross so we might have redemption. And he's coming again.
Amen.
And I look forward to that. If it happened today, be all right.
Yeah.
If you're in the midst of preaching, I'm going to go anyway, brother. I'm not going to wait till you get done.
I'm not going to wait till I get done.
Amen. Song is entitled The Next Time He Comes. From the lofty courts of heaven came a bud on earth to bloom, knowing when he left his father that his fate would be the tomb. But the grave it could not hold him. Angels rolled the stone away. Now the mighty rose of Sharon is still blooming yet today. But the next time he comes, he won't have to die for me. The next time he comes, there won't be a Calvary. The next time he comes, we'll begin eternity. And when he comes again, he'll be coming for me. I remember when I met him, how the Spirit took control. He established my going, now he stars in my life's role. For a man to come from heaven, knowing then of Calvary, oh, what love beyond all measure that he'd give his life for me. But the next time he comes, he won't have to die for me. The next time he comes, there won't be a Calvary. The next time he comes, we'll begin eternity. And when he comes again, he'll be coming for me.
Amen. Thank you for that, Brother Lamus. I appreciate that. We're studying verse by verse through the book of Luke, and so this morning we start Luke chapter 12, if you would. And if you find your place there in Luke chapter 12, somebody doesn't have a Bible near you, you can share with them if you would, so they might see God's word as well as hear it. And we're going to stand together because we honor this book. This is God's preserved words. And so I'm going to be reading Luke chapter 12, verse 1 through 5. Luke chapter 12, 1 through 5, God's word says, "In the meantime, when there were gathered together an innumerable multitude of people, insomuch that they trode one upon another, he began to say unto his disciples first of all, Beware ye of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. For there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, neither hid, that shall not be known. Therefore, whatsoever ye have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light, and that which ye have spoken in the ear in closets shall be proclaimed upon the housetops. And I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. But I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. Fear him which after he hath killed hath power to cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. Would you bow together for a word of prayer? Father, as we come before you, we thank you that we've been able to be in your presence already this morning for some time. And we thank you for the good lesson that we learned in Sunday school. And it's so important for us to understand that you're God, and we can't fully figure that all out, how you can be three persons and yet one God, how you can be in our hearts if we know you through Jesus Christ as Savior and yet still in heaven. It's just an incredible thing. But God, your ways are higher than our ways, and who can know them? And so we come before you worshiping you, for you are worthy of all praise and glory and honor. And we thank you that you sent Jesus Christ to die at Calvary. But we thank you also that he's coming again to take out his own. And so we're just looking for that day. Maybe today, maybe soon. Father, I pray that you'd meet needs. I don't know all that's going through the heart and mind of anyone that's here today. But Lord, your word is what we need. You've said man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Amen. And so we're going to be looking at your word. Would you just work in such a way that we'd be strengthened and be able to better serve you? And Lord, those that are listening in by way of the internet, may they come to know Jesus as Savior if they don't already. And so please work. Lord God, I'm not worthy to stand here, but you've chosen, you've appointed me to be here, and so I ask once again for thy anointing of the Holy Ghost upon me, that I might be able to give forth the word as the Old Testament prophets did, thus saith the Lord, and may we receive it. And so please, Spirit of God, if you're not here, not present, what is this time together but nothing but a vanity? And so, Lord, I want your blessings, your presence, for my people's sake and for these visitors, that they would get something well, and we'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. As we start chapter 12, I kind of wondered here, why is this crowd, this innumerable number of people that are here, this innumerable multitude? It says they're in so much that they trode one upon another. In other words, they knocked each other down, sometimes even stepped on one another. I kind of wondered about that. I wondered because we've just gotten done with Luke chapter 11 here, where Jesus denounces the Pharisees. I kind of wondered if maybe it had something to do with, could they have heard Jesus saying these things about the Pharisees and the lawyers? I didn't know. I just kind of asked myself if that might have been what it was. I have a tendency to think that they got to shouting. When we look there at verse 53 and 54 of chapter 11, it said, "And as he said these things unto them, the scribes and the Pharisees began to urge him vehemently and to provoke him to speak of many things, laying wait for him and seeking to catch something out of his mouth that they might accuse him." I have this mental picture that Jesus went in to the Pharisee's house, and you know, then the Pharisee was all upset because he didn't wash his hands. He didn't wash before eating. And then he started in on them, and I almost picture Jesus kind of backing out of the house, you know, telling them, you know, "Ah, you Pharisees, you're just hypocrites." He's just kind of backing out, and they're yelling all kinds of things at him, and the people come running. What is this commotion? What's going on? Can you imagine? I just wonder if that's what it was. I don't know. I really just don't know what happened there. But he turned here in verse 12 to his disciples, We see there, chapter 12, verse 1. At the end of it, it says, he began to say unto his disciples first of all. And so he turned it into a teaching moment. You know, there's all kinds of times during every one of our days that we can turn these things into teaching moments to tell somebody else about something. Now, when you work at work, if you ever get caught in the blood, boy, isn't that blood upsetting to us? You know, and just think, Jesus shed his blood for us.
Amen.
You know, a teaching moment. You can do those kinds of things. It's just amazing. But he wanted to teach them and teach them about their tendency toward hypocrisy. By the way, we all have a tendency to be hypocrites. I think the worst thing that any one of us that know Jesus Christ as Savior could be called is to be called a hypocrite. Mm-hmm. A terrible, terrible, terrible thing. We also see that he went on here and taught them some truth, life-saving truth about fear and whom to fear. And we want to take a look at that this morning. I titled my message, "We're Either Hell-Fearing or Hell-Frying." People that don't fear hell, and there's a whole lot of people go around, no fear, no fear. Mm-hmm. And one day, they are going to burn in hell.
That's right.
It's a real place. Jesus knew it, yes. Knew about it, and warned about it, spoke more about it than he did about heaven. And so I want us this morning to examine our heart. Are you a hypocrite? I know that for myself, when I ask that question, I know there's areas in my life that I am. I can't get away from it. Can't get out from under my own thumb. I understand that about myself, but I want to be more like the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And he deals in love for their souls with these ideas. First of all, in verse 1, I see the hypocrite's disposition. You know, what kind of a person is the hypocrite? The hypocrite's disposition. The apostles are their disciples. Maybe it's 70 of them. I'm not sure. But they're there, and he says to them, "Beware ye of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy." Now, folks, leaven. We understand leaven is what makes bread rise. And by the way, communion ought not to ever have leaven in it.
Amen.
Because it is a picture of sin. All the sacrifices in the Old Testament, except for one, are always to be without leaven. Now, leaven's a picture of sin. The first place that you see it is in Exodus chapter 12 and verse number 15. Exodus chapter 12, verse number 15. I won't belabor this, but understand this. Exodus chapter 12, verse 15. We read this, 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread. Even the first day ye shall put away leaven out of your houses. For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. In other words, put them out. Get rid of them. They eat leavened bread during those 7 days. It's just not right. The leaven is something God says, no, it's a picture of sin. Look with me in Leviticus chapter 2 and verse number 11. Leviticus chapter 2 and verse 11. And the scripture here talks about a meat offering. Now remember, meat is something to eat. It's not meat like steak or chicken or something like that. A meat offering in the Old Testament was always, you know, of grain. Whenever they had the other kinds of offerings, it was a lamb, it was a goat, it was a bullock, whatever. So verse 11 says, "No meat offering which ye shall bring unto the Lord shall be made with leaven, for ye shall burn no leaven nor honey in any offering of the Lord made by fire." I don't really understand the honey part of it, but he said don't do that. But the leaven, I understand, it's a picture of sin. Take a look with me in Matthew's Gospel, if you would, chapter 13 and verse 33, because here's a place where people get mixed up. Matthew chapter 13, verse 33. Matthew 13:33 says this, "Another parable spake he unto them, The kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of meal till the whole was leavened. And people say this about it. Why, this is the church, and they're taking into the world the gospel, and then the whole world gets saved, and what a great thing that is. Well, let me just say this. The gospel is never called leaven. It's called a seed. The other thing, the church is never called a woman. The church is called the elect lady. The church is called a bride. The church is called the chaste virgin, but never a woman. And so really what this is all about is the kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, in that sin gets in and spoils the whole thing. If you were to take just a little yeast and water and put it then into a bag of flour, it'd eventually ruin the whole flour. It ruined the whole thing. There's a ruination that's talked about here, not the gospel. The gospel doesn't ruin.
That's right.
Amen. Amen. The gospel changes for the good, not for the bad. And so this is not about, you know, us getting the gospel out. I just wanted to throw that in. You don't have to pay any more in the plate for it. So this one is a picture of sin ruining the children of God. And it will. It'll get in. And I've seen it get in churches. And get in there, and it just works its way around, ruins a whole bunch of people. Yeah. It really can. So come back, if you would, here to Luke chapter 12. And we're looking at that disposition of the Pharisees. What are Pharisees like? Well, their speech and their actions don't match. You know, that's one thing. I should have left you there in Matthew. I'm sorry. In Matthew chapter 23, he talks about these kinds of things here in verse number 3. He says this in Matthew chapter 23, verse 3. I'm so sorry. I should have left you there. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do. But do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. Their speech and their actions don't match. Here's the second thing about Pharisees. They want to be seen of men. That's the most important thing for them. They just want to be seen of men. You notice there at verse 6, that, and love the uppermost rooms at the feast and chief seats in the synagogues. They don't want to do anything in secret. In fact, for them to do something virtuous in secret is almost sinful for them. What? You really want me to pray without anybody seeing me? What? You want me to give anonymously to somebody? You got to be kidding me. They've got to have 1,000 eyes looking at everything that they do. Pharisees. Here's a third thing. They love titles. Matthew chapter 23 and verse 7 says, "And greetings in the markets, and to be called of men, Rabbi, Rabbi." They want to have some kind of title. Oh, I want to run for deacon in the church so I can have the title. I want to be the head usher in the church because I want the title. Yeah, those kinds of things, you know, that's Phariseeism. Then here's a fourth thing we see in Matthew chapter 23, verse 23 and 24. It says there, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought ye to have done, and not to leave the other undone. Ye blind guides, which strain at a gnat and swallow a camel." The fourth thing about them is they're more careful about little things than big things. You know, they'll strain at a gnat. So the picture is they're going to drink something and they see one of them little tiny bugs floating around. Children, you've seen those little tiny bugs, haven't you? Sometimes when you're outside, you know, at the picnic or something, you go to drink and there's one of them little tiny bugs got in your drink and that kind of thing, and take your finger and get him out. You know, they'll do that, but a whole camel could be in their cup and they'd drink it right down. Miss the big things. Always on the little things, the little nitpicky things. Why they don't carry their Bible the right way. Look at them. They've got the binding upside down. Huh, they can't be very spiritual if they do that. Huh? My, oh, my, oh, my. The things that hypocrites will look for in other people, huh? And leave out the weighty things, the judgment, you know, law, mercy, faith. Just looking at all the little things like they did with Jesus. He didn't wash before he sat down to eat. No law said he had to. Here's a fifth thing. They had no inward holiness, only outward show. That's all they had. You look in there in Matthew chapter 23, verse 27, says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye are like unto whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness." Outward stuff seems pretty good, but inwardly not. Here's the sixth thing. They're only spiritual when they're in church. Get them at work. Get them in the home. Get them some other place. Get them at the ball game, whatever. Worst thing somebody said to one of my men when they came in, a visitor came in, he said to one of my men, "I didn't know you went to church." And here he was, one of the ushers, Pastor Lamas. "I didn't know you went to church." Terrible thing. Here's number seven. Seventh thing about Phariseeism, hypocrites. They're severe with others, but lenient with themselves. Severe with others, lenient with themselves. I said to a hypocrite, "My, oh my, you're pretty tight with your money." They'd say, "Oh, no. I'm just being very wise with my money." If I said to them, "Wow, you took that merchant and they gave you the wrong change." They'd say, no, I'm just pretty good at getting deals. You know, that kind of thing. Wow. If I said to them, "You're pretty proud," he said, no. I know my proper place in this world. If we said, "Man, oh man, you're kind of fawning all over those people. Why are you doing that?" That hypocrite would say, "Well, you know, I'm to be all things to all men, mm-hmm. that I might win some." Mm-hmm. Jesus said, "Beware of the leaven of the hypocrites, of the Pharisees," which is hypocrisy here. We don't want to be hypocrites. We want to live what God tells us to live in this book. Amen. But then we look at another thing that Jesus deals with here. In verse 2 and 3, he talks about the hypocrite's disclosure. The hypocrite's disclosure. Jesus says here, "For there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, neither hid that shall not be known. Therefore, whatsoever ye have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light, and that which ye have spoken in the ear in the closets shall be proclaimed upon the housetops." You know what I have as a picture of this? Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, someday I see a big screen up in heaven like this screen right here. And all of my life's going to be projected up there. And the things in the dark are going to be shown, all the things I said, everything going to be projected up there if it's not under the blood of Jesus Christ. Everything's going to be hid. How about for those people that don't know Jesus Christ as their Savior? See, by coming to Jesus and confessing it as sin and repenting of it and turning from it and putting it all under the blood, I mean, it's not going to be a lot up there, I hope, for all of you. But for the lost, everything's going to be up there because they're going to die in their sins. They're still going to be in their sins. They're all going to be up there. The hypocrite, who on the outside is going around, "Boy, am I holy, am I something, I'm really something for God." God's going to put up there all the things of his heart and mind and all the things that came out of his mouth. It's going to be something. Jesus is kind of saying here, "Hey, let's take a look at your checkbook." Well, you think you've got a profit there, huh? Well, I think not. Jesus is kind of saying to them, "You think you're getting away with it?" Nope. I see it all. See, man looks on the outward. God looks on the heart. You can fool us all the time. You never can fool God. Can't get your hypocrisy past him. It just won't happen. I'd ask you to turn back to Matthew again, if you would, chapter 12, please. And verse 36 and 37. Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 and 37. We see here what Jesus said to the people and says to us. Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 and 37. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Boy, if out of my mouth I say that person can't be very holy, there's my words. That person can't be very holy. That thing's going to turn right around and point right at me. If I say that person can't be very holy because look at that. They put other things on top of their Bible. Don't they know the Bible ought to be preeminent, ought to be on the top? I mean, God said his word is more important than his name. And I point at them and say that, then that's going to turn right around and point right at me. And God's going to say to me, you know, you could have read your Bible, but you read that magazine. You could have read your Bible, but you were on the internet. You could have read your Bible. You were saying they didn't have the Bible on top. You didn't have it in your heart on top either. You hypocrite. I thought, man, everything's going to be exposed to us. And what things of our mouth? Now, if you're in the habit of speaking truth, do you know what? You'll never have to hide. You'll never have to be ashamed. If you make your life such that it matches up best you can with the Word of God in this body of flesh that's sinful, but if you try your hardest and you try to say out of your mouth what things are right and true, you know, you don't have to worry. You know what's amazing about people that lie? And hypocrisy is a lie. It's a outward lie. You know, people that lie, they're always worried. Now, what did I say the last time? Ooh, you know, am I sure I remember? Now, folks, before I got saved, I'm telling you the truth. I was a liar. I mean, I used to tell people that I went to Syracuse University. Well, I did. I used to walk onto the campus, do my laundry. And I even worked there. But I told people I used to go to Syracuse University. Oh, yeah, I went to Syracuse University. So what class were you in? Well, you know, it's a big campus, a lot of students. You know, we probably never had classes together. Don't worry about it. Lie, 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 lie. All the time. All kinds of lies. But you're always wondering, let me see, what did I tell them last time? If you just live the truth, don't have to worry about it. Don't have to have any kind of those concerns, amen? If you do that. And you see, a hypocrite has no peace of mind or heart because they're always wondering, what am I covering up that's going to be revealed? You know, when is it really going to come out that I'm not who I say I am? When are people going to find out that this facade that I've put on in front is really not me? And they struggle with that all the time. Verse 3 here in chapter 12, one forgets that many people might think we're great. But God wants nothing to do with them. Verse 3 tells us, therefore, whatsoever you have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light. And that which you have spoken in the ear in closets shall be proclaimed upon the housetops. You know, in the book of Ecclesiastes, now I want to have you turn over there to Ecclesiastes chapter 10. Remember, it's Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. So if you get there, you went too far. Ecclesiastes. Here's the wisest man in the world. And he writes these things down. Ecclesiastes chapter 10 and verse number 20 says this. Ecclesiastes 10:20, curse not the king. Really? I mean, I can't say something about President Bush. I can't say something about President Obama. Curse not the king, no, not in thy thought. And curse not the rich in thy bedchamber, for a bird of the air shall carry the voice, and that which hath wings shall tell the matter. You ever have somebody say, you ask them, how'd you know that? A little birdie told me. That's where we get that from, right there. A little birdie told me. Guess what? It'll get out. Now, Adam, I tell my folks, I'm really good at keeping secrets. It's the people I tell those things to that can't keep the secret for me. Amen? And a little birdie. You know what? One day hypocrites are going to be stripped of their fig leaves. And God's going to do some things that they never thought. Look with me in Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 14, the very last verse of the book. It says this, "For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil." One day it's all going to come out. It's all going to be disclosed. But I'd like to go on this morning. And Jesus deals in love with his disciples about this idea. Thirdly, the hypocrite's dose of cure. Verse 4 and 5. Luke chapter 12, verse 4 and 5. The hypocrite's dose of cure. "And I say unto you, my friends." Isn't that something that he calls them, friends? You see, when we don't know Jesus as Savior, we're not friends of God, not in the family of God like everybody wants us to think. No, no, no. We only become friends when we become born again, saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. When he who died and rose again the third day is the Lord, Master of our life and Savior personally in your life, not a generalized idea of Savior, but the Savior. He's about... "And I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body." And then he goes on in verse 5, "But I will forewarn you, whom ye shall fear, fear him, which after he hath killed, hath power to cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him." Now, I know right away, there's liberals out there that are going to say, "Now, Pastor, oh, don't say those kinds of things. Perfect love casteth out fear. Oh, don't scare the children with this talk about hell and fire and burning and all that kind of..." I'd rather scare them and have them burn in hell. I'd rather have them hell-fearing than hell-frying any day. Amen? "And that perfect love casteth out fear." Yes, if you're saved, you've got no fear, as verse 4 says, about them that kill the body. I mean, what's the worst they can do? They kill you, and there you are, absent from the body, present with the Lord. I like that. You know, I almost want to say, if some robber comes up to me with a gun, except for my wife and kids, you know, I want to say, "Go ahead, please. Oh, I can't wait. I've been waiting for this for a long time now." Amen. I mean, I've been saved 30, I don't know how many years, 35, 36, 37 years, 38 years, I don't know what it is anymore. You know, I've been waiting a long time for this. Put me up there, please. You know, I think I'd fear more the guy that wants to torture me than the guy who's just going to, you know, plug me and put me right into the presence of the Lord, you know. Yeah, amen. I like that. You dial the number. You plug them, we plant them. I like that. Amen. But see, folks, a hypocrite ought to be afraid. Because if a hypocrite thinks that they're all right with God and they're doing all these external things, and that's what the Pharisees did. By the way, the Pharisees, as Pastor Lamas pointed out to us in Sunday school, they were the ones who were the strict orthodox of the day. They'd be the fundamentalists of the day. And yet they were not right with God. The Sadducees would be the liberals of the day. They didn't believe the Bible. They didn't say, well, angels, if you want to believe them, you don't have to, whatever. Resurrection, nah, you don't have to believe in any of that kind of stuff. They're liberals of the day, and they weren't right with God either.
Right.
Mm. Now, there can be some watching by way of the internet that are hypocrites, that think that they're all right with God. You know, there's all kinds of people think they're good. I'll tell you about a guy. I'll change his name, but he was in my church. He was a guy, and I'll just call him Greg, just because we got Brother Greg Davis coming. I'll just call him Greg. That's not his real name, but I'll call him Greg. He was our youth leader in our church. You know, after a while, we'd had quite a revival at our church, Pastor Lamas. I mean, old-fashioned Holy Spirit revival in our church. People are getting saved. And, you know, there's a lot of them that said, you know, when I was a kid, I just wanted to please the Sunday school teacher. So I just said, yeah, I've asked Jesus to be my Savior. Well, Greg here, one night he came forward in the service, tears running down his face. He said, I'd watched this man, and as you talked about, somebody had come over to their house, and he ramrod his dad and his mom, and they prayed a prayer, and his mom wasn't saved. His dad did get saved, as far as I know. But he said, I watched them, and I knew he was going to come to me. So I made up a story that I'd gotten saved by so-and-so. He talked to me at the, he made up some place that they met at, and you know, and sure, they had met there, but they didn't talk about salvation. Sure. And he made this story up, and here he was, the hypocrite. Mm-hmm. You know, and there he is working with the teens. And you know what he said to the church family? You never asked me if I was saved. You just let me work with all the teens. Mm. And he said, I know I'm lost. I've got to get saved tonight. And he turned right from there. I mean, tears coming down. Turned right there, knelt down, and he cried out for Jesus to save him. Changed his life. When his mom watched that. And his mom was a good woman. She really was. She was a good woman, never said anything bad about anybody in her whole life. Never did anything with the boys she shouldn't do. None of that stuff. I mean, she obeyed her parents as a kid. I mean, she thought that Jesus, plus all of her being good, was how she'd get to heaven. And then she realized she's a lost sinner, a hypocrite, through and through, on her way to hell. And her mom, his mom got saved, too.
Amen.
You know? And see, if you understand that you need to fear hell because it's a real place, and people that don't know Jesus as Savior are going to go there. That's what they deserve. It's not God being mean to them.
That's right.
It's just that they're lost, and they need Jesus Christ as Savior. And so he tells them about this, about this place. There are those that can kill the body. But I like verse 4, it says there, verse 4, and I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. Mm-hmm. What can they do after that? That's it. I mean, that's, you know, it's kind of final. At that point, I mean, what do they want to do? Grind you up, make you into fertilizer? I mean, you know, it's nothing. Amen. But verse 5, he says, but I forewarn you. I'm standing here ahead of time, and I forewarn you. I'm going to ask you to turn back, please, to Isaiah chapter 66. It's the last chapter of Isaiah. All the way back there to Isaiah chapter 66, and I want you to take a look at verse 24. And the reason I want you to look at the last verse of the book of Isaiah is that this is the verse quoted by Jesus more than any other Old Testament verse. He says this in Isaiah 66, verse 24, and they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me, for their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched, and they shall be an abhorring unto all flesh. Jesus quoted that more times. They're going to be in hell fire, where the worm dieth not, and the fire will not be quenched. It won't go out. A dose of cure for the hypocrites is to put them in front of the realities of hell and understand that they need to fear him, God, who after their body has been killed can cast them into hell and justly do it. Hell's a real place.
That's right.
So I ask you this morning, which's better for you? Hell fearing or hell frying? Where would you rather be? I'll tell you the truth. The hottest day that I've ever been in, I was out in Nevada, Arizona, right on the border there at that Hoover Dam. It was 115 degrees. You know what? That's going to feel like a cool place compared to what people are going to experience in hell. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, in hell, a person would have a drink of water. He wouldn't care if it was room temperature. In fact, he wouldn't even care if it was lukewarm. He wouldn't care if it was hot water. Mm-hmm. It'd still be cooler than anything in hell.
Right.
Be sure your sin will find you out, the scripture says. These things are going to be known. I read this week about a man, 1725 or so around there, that decided he was going to rob a church. While he was inside the church at night, the men in the community heard him somehow or other in there, and they started running toward the church. And the man got into a panic, and he tried to hide some things in his coat, and he was in a panic because he could hear the men coming with the torches and that kind of thing. So he ran toward the front of the church, and he thought, and he was upstairs in the church. Back in those days, when they built the church, they made classroom things on the first floor and the auditorium be on the second floor. So he's up there, he robbed the communion plates, which were made out of gold. And he saw a rope hanging out the window, and he saw the rope went down to the ground, and he thought, man, I'll just slide down that rope and that'll be great. So he grabbed a hold of that rope and jumped out that window, and it was the rope to the bell. And the bell started ringing, and they knew right where he was. Dear ones, one day, everything about us is going to be disclosed.
Yes, sir.
It's all going to be known. Mm-hmm. Won't be hid. Jesus said, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. Mm-hmm. Don't let hypocrisy get in your life. Let's Amen. Bow together for a word of prayer. I'm going to ask every head to be bowed and every eye closed. Maybe there's somebody by way of the internet that doesn't know Jesus Christ as Savior. Because you reject Jesus Christ, hell is what you deserve. Hell is your destiny if you don't repent. And repent means to understand that sin is bad, it's an affront against a holy God, and turn from it. And also understand that all those good works and all that stuff you do for your church or whatever, that isn't going to get you to heaven either. The only thing that'll get you to heaven is what Jesus did when he died on the cross, and he shed his blood and he paid for your sin. He was buried and rose again the third day, the Bible says, according to the scriptures, for your sins. And if you'd cry out where you are, Jesus, be merciful to me, a sinner, he'll save you. If you honestly and earnestly understand that you deserve hell, he'll save you. Better for you to be hell-fearing than hell-frying, my dear one. Please, where you are, won't you pray? Won't you cry out to God? God, I understand my sin is ever before me. Against thee and thee only have I sinned. Jesus, you died on that cross, shed your blood and was buried, rose again the third day. Please, would you save me? Come into my heart and life and be Lord and Master there. Pray something like that earnestly this morning. Jesus, save me, and he'll save you. You that know Jesus as your Savior, what about that leaven of the Pharisees? What about that hypocrisy? What about putting on a front and not living the truth, living a lie before God? It isn't pleasing to him. It's better that you go before God and be honest and say, God, woe is me, I'm undone. I'm unclean and of unclean lips. Lord, I don't want to do the devil's work in my Savior's clothes. Forgive me, cleanse me, make me right. Father, as I pray, I just ask that men and women, boys and girls, all over would understand. They'll never fool you. They need to be right with you. And please, if it's salvation, may they come to know you as Savior. If it's because of hypocrisy in their life, they know you as Savior, but they're trying to live something that they're not. They're trying to make people think they're holier than they really are. Please, dear God, would you help us to be Judgment Day honest? Just like that day when everything's going to be revealed, may we be that way in front of one another today. We'll thank you for all you do in our life. May we please you, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Dear ones, I want to give you a time of invitation. I'm going to ask Pastor Lamas to come and lead us in 293, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. 293 in your hymn books. Let's stand together. And if God's spoken to you in some way, won't you come? We're here to help. You can come here, kneel at the front. You can kneel at the chair that you're at. I don't care where you get right with God, but if you need to get right with God about something today, do it as Pastor Lamas leads us in this hymn.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by.
In a word of prayer, please.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the love you do have for us. We thank you today that we're reminded that we don't need to be hypocrites in how we are in our own lives, Father, in our own private lives. Father, we just pray as we leave today that we are reminded of this. Pray, Father, that you strengthen our lives and keep our eyes on Jesus Christ. Father, we pray now that should somebody have heard this message and is unsaved, that they would accept Christ as their Savior. We pray that you keep us safe as we travel home. Lord, we ask this now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen. Lord bless you, dear ones. Thank you.